Hi everyone, this is Suzanne Wagner. Thank you for joining me. We are doing the numerology and the astrology for December 5th, 2020. If you add all those numbers together, you get the number 12. And if you add the 1 and the 2 together, you get the number 3. For some, life may feel like a carnival ride that has gotten somehow out of control. You want off the ride, but you end up hanging on for dear life. For others, it may feel like a hustle and a tussle. Life is spinning crazily out of control. Everyone can feel it. While you go through the motions of normal, nothing feels normal deep down inside. But in life, the choice is always to keep on keeping on and doing what you can to remain calm and do things from the place of good common sense and kindness. Remember, the best accessory you can put on each morning is a smile. The astrology today, the moon is in Leo, and it tends for us to open our heart and connect with others in ways that really make a difference. Take pride in our ability to care for those needing the greatest help and make sure all our actions reflect the values we truly feel. The sun semi-squares Saturn, which can make those serious choices and decisions seem more critical than ever. Our choices take on a more serious tone. It's essential that we shift out of a me identity towards a society that protects those most in need. It is up to us. Where we are at in the world is our responsibility. But Venus and Neptune trining give us a much needed opportunity to play a bit, laugh, and give us inspiration to keep going. I know it is hard to trust, but we need to take the hate sunglasses off and decide to see the goodness in humanity over the horror. Even if it is just for a moment, you may look at the past and romanticize the reality. You may look to the future and also fantasize about the possibility that right now does not exist. Venus and Mars quincux early in the morning. Expect that feeling of dis-ease to be felt today. It is hard to feel everything that is bubbling up. We want to feel better than we feel, but we have to learn to be honest with our personal process and do lots of self-care. It's going to be a long winter. Okay, and my quote for today was the one I said earlier in the numerology. Remember, the best accessory you can put on each morning is a smile. All right, now, my blog for today. Listening to the news is, I try not to listen to the news, but of course, I'm at my mother's house, and that's what old people do, is listen to the news. And so as we seem to come into a holiday season filled with coronavirus intensity, I hope that calm minds and passionate hearts open in compassion to those that are suffering the most. We all have to learn restraint in life. I believe that each of us in our own way are learning how to stop and be with our deepest selves. And that is a good thing. We have been a society all about instant gratification for a long time, and now we are learning a very different lesson. Notice how much busyness has been avoidance of what we have not wanted to feel. Notice how much distraction has been the agenda of ego to keep us in overwhelm so we do not have to feel what was hidden in the dark corners of our psyche. In all great spiritual teachings, a soul must be in stillness and silence for a minimum of, remember, 40 days and 40 nights, in order to confront the internal darkness within. Some teachings have monks be in silence for 3 years, 3 months, 3 days, 3 hours, 3 minutes, and 3 seconds. In speaking to one of my monk friends, he said that what he learned was the temporariness of life. He said, if you are in silence and not bathing, for such long periods of time, you learn the body is slowly rotting underneath you. While body is a miracle on so many levels, it is not going to survive forever, and you have to see all of life as a temporary experience. This makes you recognize that kings will also rot away, priests will also rot away, so we will also rot away. From such a position, the dramas of life disperse in importance, and we see that what is right here, right now, is all that is guaranteed. Therefore, we have to do what we can in every moment to contribute from an open and honest heart. The past means nothing except to show us the lessons needing to be embraced. The future is not guaranteed, and this moment becomes everything. Embrace the emptiness within, embrace the now, and embrace the journey of your soul in this particular incarnation. Okay. When I moved to California, which is like 10 years ago now, when I moved to California, my business went from like 100%, you know, down to 30% because I was suddenly not in Salt Lake City and I was doing things more over the phone, and the internet at that particular time was not as good as it is now at the house where I live now. And thank God for technology. Everything has improved so much. And I look at the universe and I go, there's no way with my business that I could have lived where I live now before that moment, because the technology wasn't there. I needed the internet. I needed the access to clients. I needed the advertising. I needed all these things just to connect with people. And it was finally the remote living thing started to kind of be a fad about 10 years ago. And people started moving out of the cities and moving more into the country and wanting to have more of a life. And so I was so excited. I was like going down my little dirt road, my little dirt country road with the trees on both sides of coming in. And I was just like, oh my God, pinch me. And this is so incredibly beautiful. This is so amazing. And then I got there, and what happened was that everything slowed down and stopped. And I don't think I had ever really slowed down in my whole entire life. I had two perfectionistic parents that were incredibly driven for totally different reasons. And my sister's a doctor, so you can imagine the drive and energy that she has. And all of a sudden, for the first time in my life, at the age of 50, I had less to do. And I freaked out. I mean, in all honesty, I freaked out. And I've always noticed how the universe teaches me lessons before it becomes a lesson that's a global lesson. And in this case, this is one of them, because now everybody has been kind of forced to stop. And it's freaked some people out. It's brought up a lot of stuff. It's brought up a lot of emotion. I see it in the dynamics in my own family. And it's hard, you know, to be still and to not have distractions coming at you that deflect you from your own internal process, which is why in meditation, it's like, who is here? I am here. Who's breathing? I am breathing. Who's eating? I am eating. Who's walking? I am walking. And so you know, in meditation courses, you're not allowed to talk to other people. You're not allowed to look at other people. You're not allowed to smile at other people. You're supposed to be totally immersed in your own process. And while I had done that and I'd done Vipassana retreats, you know, for long periods of time and meditated, it's different when suddenly it's like the floor falls out from the world. And, you know, we didn't have television at that particular time. I was on a budget, you know, everything was tightening up on so many levels. And, you know, I suddenly was like, wow, okay, I'm going to do the Pema Chodron stuff. And Pema Chodron, you know, says, sit in the shimpa, sit in the misery of the truth of where you're at. And so I just kind of kept sitting there being in the misery of the truth. And when I went under layers, what I got down to was resentment. And what was so shocking to me was that, you know, I've worked on anger like crazy and fear like crazy, and I've worked on all these deep emotions. And so anger doesn't bother me. Fear doesn't bother me. People can be pissed at me. I don't really care. You know, I mean, it's like that part doesn't bother me because my own anger terrifies me more than your anger could possibly terrify me. So when you get down to the bottom of that, it's like all this other stuff is just noise. It becomes noise. But I hadn't actually worked with resentment. And in my mind, resentment and anger should have been the same, but they're not. And I learned that lesson in a process called the Game of Life many, many, many years ago, where you had to embody words. And it was so interesting to watch people who needed to embody integrity not know how to feel integrity separate from love or separate from trust. And that it was very hard to isolate certain particular feelings within the body. And so for me in that moment in 2010, the feeling was resentment. Now, there were a lot of pieces that were coming together because of that, you know, that, you know, me trying to move to California was a gigantic shit show. It was, you know, I have this funny thing in my chart that when change happens, it's extremely bizarre and dramatic. Like, and, you know, even the astrologers say, well, you know, you have Uranus conjunct your sun, of course, you know, shit's going to blow up when you try to change. And so my whole life has been like this series of things exploding. And so that was just one of the ones exploding. And so I had moved to California to be with my wonderful husband, and he got a job in India, and he was gone for the next 8 years. And so here I am, I've moved to a remote place. And you know, I'm in a small town where nobody knows me. And it's kind of hard to break into small towns. It's kind of hard to have people get to know you in a small town, because they, lots of those people have been there forever and they know everybody, right? So you suddenly are the odd duck coming in. And so I'm a really odd duck coming in the door. So anyway, I just sat with this Shempa. I sat with the misery of the resentment that I felt from everything in my life being so crazy and blowing up, and having to move my mother twice, and having to move my assistant, and having to pay for all these things, and having, you know, my business suddenly drop down to 30%. And I had to, you know, work with all of those pieces within me. And I was like, wow, you know, like I have never really looked at resentment. And I give this as a long example because I really know that everybody who's been in quarantine and has had to stop has had shit coming up. I mean, I know what that feels like. I have so much compassion. I really do, because it's really hard to stop and not have anything to distract you from yourself. And you are face to face with everything that's still unresolved in your psyche. And trust me, there can be a lot of stuff. And so just resentment, I'm not talking about anything else, but just resentment. I sat with a year and a half, like every day for 3 hours, I sat with resentment. And I learned so much about resentment and my resentment and where it's really coming from and what the root of it really is, because it's not really what you think it is at first. You know, it's like you think it's about, I resent what they did, and it's never about that. It's never at the bottom of the whole thing. It's never about anybody else. It is always about you. And so I think in a weird way, it's like the universe has put everybody on this planet in a giant Vipassana course. It's like, they were like, hey, you have not just 40 days and 40 nights, but you have like 6 months plus of learning to be still and learning to feel, you know, and noticing what you've been avoiding your whole entire life. And, you know, again, when I was young, the guide said to me, no part of yourself may be left behind in the transition. And I was like, oh, okay. But I mean, resentment can't be left behind. Like, you have to embrace all the darkness that you are too. And this last 4 years has been a constant kaleidoscope of humanity's darkness. And I go, if you can see it, then it is a reflection to you. So it's like, you know, I operate from like, oh, wow, look at that person lying. Where do I lie? You know, where am I lying? Where am I not telling myself the truth? You know, where am I, where is one part lying to another part of myself, right? So, you know, it's like the external is simply a reflection of the internal. And that can be really rough. That for the last 4 years, that's been really rough. Like, oh my gosh, I'm a mess, right? You know, so you look at all these pieces and you try and embrace them and you try and breathe into them and you try and accept them. And when you do that, something inside of you heals and becomes more whole and becomes less reactive. So at this point in the game, nature on my land has taught me a lot. Learning to go slow. Learning that things don't have to be done instantly. Learning that everything when you are way far out from town takes a long time. Learning that people don't show up when you ask them to do work and they don't follow through and they don't finish. What do you do then? You know, it's like, okay, well, there's a perfect place for resentment. I don't think I want to do resentment. I think I want to like find another method of engaging rather than coming from a place of anger and frustration and you didn't do what you said and stuff like that. So this is a weird long blog today, but you know, really kind of like embrace the fact that we're going to be on another 6-month quarantine. I mean, like just embrace that, you know, there might be something deeper that the universe is asking all of us to do. It's not just you or me. It's like, it's everybody. I mean, like, wow, talk about a global class. I think this is like Vipassana 101 for the planet. And I think the bears and the deer and elk are having a fine time with it. They don't have a problem with it. But I think humanity has a problem with not living in their mind. Okay, thanks. I hope that was entertaining for everybody. Okay, bye.